Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your most favorite brother from another mother. It's late. I wasn't going to make a video, but I just felt a compulsion from the Lord to go ahead and come on here and make a quick video, brothers and sisters. I just want to say God bless you all. I want you to know, that every day I have people, that I'm pastoring on through the YouTube ministry, and I don't have time to make videos every day. Then of course we got all the things going on in the Philippines. We got a full ministry there too, besides and then a YouTube ministry. So thank God, brothers and sisters, that the Lord gave me the opportunity and the time and the energy to do it. But I just want to just mention, prayer request. And those people ask me for a prayer request, I'm praying for you guys. Just want to mention people from YouTube. That's Sister Barbara, who's that God's Healer 777. Now, and Pastor Paul Begley. I just want to say that it doesn't matter, if you watch their videos or not, or if you like their teachings or not, or whatever. Within Christianity, there's thousands of denominations, which it ought not be, brothers and sisters, but they are. So people disagree all the time about all kinds of doctrinal things, but we brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus said, people in John chapter 13, at the Last Supper, he said, "As a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, and people will know you're my disciples because you love the brethren." And then the Apostle John, who also wrote, that's in the Gospel of John, chapter 13. But in 1 John, one of the letters he wrote, he said, "People, you know you pass from death to life because you love the brethren." And Paul tells us, that the Lord has given us the commandment of love. So that's what it's about, brothers and sisters. Ultimately, Paul said in 1 Corinthians, chapter 13, without love, I'm nothing. That's the agape love. I just made a video or two ago talking about that, agape love, which is sacrificial giving love, that's the word there, without charity in the King James, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, after Paul had talked about the gifts of the Spirit in chapter 12 and chapter 14, right in the middle of that, he starts talking about, without love, I'm just like looks like someone beating on a brass and it doesn't make any clarity, or blowing a drum and it's no meaning to it, or, so, it's just like tongues without interpretation. It's meaningless without the lens of love. As I mentioned in the last video I made, I got that word from the Lord, really, that all the gifts of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit are looking through the prism of love. So love is like a prism, that breaks down. If you let the sunlight shine through a prism, it'll break down into the colors of the rainbow. And of course, God made it that way, and the rainbow, the real meaning of the rainbow is God is a covenant-keeping God, like with Noah. Not what they're doing today with the perversion of everything of God is they're perverting the rainbow too with homosexuality and gay marriage and all that stuff, but the LGBT community, whatever they want to call themselves. But anyhow, all of those things are within love, so without love we're nothing. And that's one of the golden nuggets that the Lord gave me on the last video that I made there, that long video. And I just say sorry for those who can't watch a 40-minute video or even skip through parts of it and pick up those nuggets, because I always put those nuggets as they're flowing, and it's in those long videos, and then the people that are running to and fro, they're not going to hear it, and they're not going to get that wisdom, So, and I believe that's how God operates, because he uses the simple things to confound the wise. And anyhow, so I ask for prayers from you guys in agreement with me for Pastor Paul and Sister Barbara. And I just want to tell you this. I wasn't going to mention all this, but I just mentioned it, not for the purpose that I had a dream. You guys who follow me, I have dreams, and then they, some of them are even like about the economic crisis started on the day of that was in my dream. But so this is not about that. This is about, in all the videos that I do, I try to give instructions on what for you as an example and what to do about it and kind of relate it in a learning experience, not... sometimes people, not often, but sometimes people do a video pulling their own chain and bragging up what they've done. You know what I mean? Instead of just, and so whenever I'm telling about something the Lord showed me, it's for the learning purpose of it. And more so than just, oh, you know, God gave me a dream and then it happened. You know what I mean? So, that being said, anyhow, Sunday night I had a dream, and I told my wife and I told Brother Gary, Bear 049, so he's my witness about this. And he had said something in that video about Sister Barbara too. I do what he said. Had to go back and review which one it was. I'm not sure, but it's on a video. But anyhow, I had this dream, and it was a long dream. But but the people from YouTube ministry were there. You know, and as an example, Brother Gary was there. Several people from YouTube who do videos, watchmen, you might want to call those us group of people, even though we don't all agree on everything, you know. But they were there, and we were on a boat. First we were on a bus, and then we got on a bigger vehicle, and a bigger vehicle, and we were on a boat. And anyhow, so we had this 10 days furlough, and we all left the boat, except for two people stayed back to watch the boat. I didn't see who it was. But we all left the boat, and in this dream, it was a long dream with lots of different parts, but I'm not going through all the parts, but just for this end piece of it. But the point is, in the dream, that everybody had different gifts. We're talking about gifts of the Spirit. But in the dream, it translated that some people could, you know, run real fast, and kind of like a superhero kind of thing, but and do different kind of things. And then for me, I could actually fly, and, you know, like meaning like going high in the Lord, prophetic seeing and all that. And so in this dream, this that I had Sunday morning, before I woke up, I was flying away, and all the people were going on this 10-day, and that means something. I don't know what. I haven't even prayed about the dream. That's what I'm trying to get at. What we need to do, pray. I looked back, and it seemed like the boat was on fire. So I started yelling to all the people, hey, the boat's on fire, the boat's on fire, let's go back. So this is like the YouTube Watchmen community, okay? And so people came back by different means. Some people were in taxis, some people were on a motorcycle, some people were flying in different ways, in an airplane. I was like flying like without any instruments or whatever, you know, like flying through the air. Anyway, so went back there, and the captain of the ship, I didn't see the captain, but I could hear his voice. So it's like the Holy Spirit or the Lord, you know, the Lord himself. And I heard a voice saying, you know, the voice of the captain saying, the boat's not on fire. And then I kept going around the boat, looking, and then I knew there was something going on, but I didn't know what it was. So I said, the boat is sinking. And I started yelling for everybody, hey, you know, the boat's sinking, and let's get the water off of it. And then the captain of the ship said, no, the boat's not sinking. and then he said, this to me, and this is, you know, why I didn't make a video about it, of course. He said, the spirit of death is on the ship, and that's what you've discerned. You know, the captain of the ship was talking to me. And so then we all ran onto the ship to look, and then there were two people lying on the floor of the ship. Now, the reason why I didn't make this video, because now the spirit of death doesn't necessarily mean somebody's going to die. It means like the devil's trying to kill people or whatever, okay? So it doesn't mean they are going to die. So, and like I said, I told Gary about this Sunday afternoon. We talked on the phone, and either Sunday or Monday. I think it was Sunday. But anyway, she got sick on Wednesday from what I hear. And Pastor Paul Begley got sick also on Wednesday. They both were sick on Wednesday. So this was before that. But that's not the point, but I'm just telling you about it. And when I went inside, Sister Barbara was lying on the ground, like unconscious. So I don't know. I didn't know what was going on, other than the captain said there was a spirit of death on the ship, and we all went running on there, and we knew that there was a couple who were left behind, a man and a woman. And so then I saw a man also lying down, and he was wearing glasses, but I was from a distance, you know, and as Paul says, we see through a glass darkly. You know, the Lord didn't let me zoom in on it to see who it was. And, you know, so I thought it was her, you know, her husband is Brother Dan. Like I said, I've only watched a few of their videos. They've commented to me on a few of my videos. I commented to them. I don't really know them. Just threw a few comments. Same thing with Pastor Begley. I never watch anybody's videos. I've only watched a few of his videos, and I've commented with him a few times over the years, and we don't really know each other. So, but anyway, so I thought maybe Brother Dan, that I heard the name Paul. And so then I said, maybe it's Minister Paul. You know, I didn't even think about Pastor Paul Begley. I thought Minister Paul, you know, is what I was thinking to myself. You know, because I heard the name Paul, and I know her husband's name is Dan. So, and then, you know, they were laying side by side. So, you know, that's how it is when we have a dream or something. Sometimes we put our own interpretation. I thought since they were laying beside each other that it had to be her and her husband. You know, I said, well, that doesn't make sense. How could they both be sick at the same time? But I heard Paul, so is it Minister Paul? Well, his wife's not really on YouTube. You know, and I knew it was Sister Barbara. And the people that were there were all, who did YouTube videos. And so I was like, well, this is confusing because I didn't think about Pastor Paul Begley. So when you get to see this thing about it, when the Lord shows you something, sometimes you jump to conclusions. And so that's what I'm trying to talk to you guys about is when we make presumptions, jump to conclusions, draw conclusions. And I've been through this many times in the past with words I got from the Lord, visions, dreams, and words I got from the Lord where I tried to add to it or take away. So when you hear from the Lord, you can't add to it or take away. And so, in this case, you think about it now. No, I only told Brother Gary in private, and I told my wife. Now, what do you do with information like that? You know what I'm saying? I don't really know Sister Barbara. I don't really, and Pastor Paul Baby is almost, impossible, to get a hold of. Let's think about it, brothers and sisters. If you message me, I will get back to you. As long as you're being nice and not being mean and rude and attacking me, I'll answer you back. And, And so now I know that Pastor Paul Begley he puts out a lot of videos and stuff. So he's so busy putting out information. Doesn't have time to chat with people. But for me, I'm trying to do more, pastoring people. So it takes time and it's not on film, on video. But anyhow, so what do you do with information like that? You tell people, oh, the Lord, I had a dream and there's a spirit of death. And that's all you lay on. What do you say to people? You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, this is the kind of things you run into. And I run into things like this all the time, brothers and sisters. There's other people who are regular viewers of mine, regular commenters, people I've visited who I know in different places in the United States, several different people that I had dreams about of something that was like bad. But as an example, in March, when I was in the Philippines, or April, March, there's a brother and sister who I know, who I visited, in their place in the United States, and I had a dream about something bad befalling the husband. And then it was like a dual meaning, economic, and I thought, wasn't sure whether it was economic or physical. I explained everything. But what happened is when I woke up from that dream, the Lord immediately told me, message the wife and tell her what your dream was. And so I did because the Lord told me to, And then just a few days later, this brother had this medical attack. He had a TIA, and it fit perfectly as an interpretation of the dream. But I didn't know what was going to happen, and I even thought it might even be economic because it was, what it was. But it could also have been a duality of the economic troubles, started in my later dream about the United States, because he's a businessman. But anyhow, and there's several other people too. And you get this like a bad news or whatever you want to call it, warning, not necessarily end result bad news, right? We're talking about a warning dream that we need to do something. Sometimes it's somebody needs to repent. Sometimes we need to go to the doctor. You need to take this medical condition seriously. You think, oh, I got a mild medical condition, but no, you need to take it seriously. It's not mild. You need to go to the doctor or whatever and take it seriously. Change your diet, whatever, if it's heart trouble or whatever. Anyhow, so what do you do with information like that? So what I wanted to say about this is number one, I don't really know them well. Now, the Lord gave me this dream. Now, I told Gary, I told my wife. But what I should have done, and I've been through this many times in the past, because the Lord gives me dreams and visions and words all the time, because I have a prophetic ministry. I'm a minister of the gospel. I'm a pastor, but my office is really the prophetic office, one of the five offices that the Lord gives to the church, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And so, and then the more prophetic you are, if you're in a prophetic, the office, then you have more of words, visions, and dreams. And that's the area where you operate in. And anyhow, so this is a classic example of I didn't have time to pray and ask the Lord, what do I do with this information? And I thought, well, it could just be a dream. Sometimes dreams are dreams. But so that's what I'm telling you guys is a lesson, an example, because I've been going through this, on occasion for the last 14 years, 15 years, that if you have a dream, a word, or a vision, and you're not sure, number one, don't ask non-believers. Don't talk to people that can't hear from the Lord. You need to seek wisdom from people who can hear from the Lord, like you, if you had a dream or a vision. I have people all the time, too. Probably every day. I have at least one person that messages me, have a dream, vision, word they had. They think it's a warning for themselves or other people. What should they do about it? They ask me to pray, you know, for a word for them or what they should do and try to help them, you know, give them pastoral. I mean, that's what I'm doing. I'm usually pastoring people in this kind of, in that kind of an area. A lot of the pastoring that I'm doing is in the prophetic area, because that's where God uses me particularly. But of course, if you're in the ministry, you cannot actually operate in any of those areas. If you're spirit filled, you can operate in, you can do evangelism, you can do all the teaching, whatever, etc. Anyhow, so brothers and sisters, that's why I'm sharing this with you as a learning experience, that you know, stop you know, investigate further. If God gives you a dream or vision or a word, you know, do your best to try to make time. Of course, you don't always have time. Do your best to make time to seek the Lord on what it means, what he wants you to do with the information, and what does it mean. Seek counsel from those people. I mean, that's what I'd say. I talked to Brother Gary Bear 049 about it, and asked him, you know, what he thought about it. Bounced it off of him because he has dreams too, to pray about it and mention it to my wife. And you know, like I say, this, but you know, the Lord didn't tell me to message them. That's what I'm saying. But sometimes he'll tell you outright, like he did me with the other brother with this with the TIA thing. And then sometimes we need to keep seeking the Lord. What is it that we need to do? So anyway, brothers and sisters, that's a little learning lesson there. And then I would just ask for your prayers for those two, Pastor Paul Bayes in the hospital. They said he had some amoeba he got in the Middle East. And, you know, we pray he's going to make a full, speedy recovery. And Sister Barbara, I know that she had a... I've been meaning to make a video this weekend. I haven't had time. I don't, like I said, I don't personally know Brother Dan and Sister Barbara, but they're fellow Christians and fellow people that make YouTube videos. And so I asked you to pray for them also. And she had surgery. And Sister Linda Kirby has been, you know, got an update this evening. This is Monday, the 19th or whatever it is of October. That the next 24 hours were critical for her. You know, she had some big embolism removed. They said it was the size of a golf ball or a baseball or something. Big old embolism or two embolisms removed. You know, like I said, so when the captain of the ship, which I believe is the Holy Spirit, because I didn't see him. Usually if you don't see him, you know, a lot of time it's referring to the Holy Spirit. Had told me that the spirit of death was on the ship. So, you know, it's, you know, the enemy is coming against people on YouTube. It seems to be that's what the Lord was trying to show me. So I would say that now that I'm just thinking about it, you know, for future events, for other people who make videos, let's pray, you know, that all the people who are Christians who make videos, and I'm talking about somebody that's a cult or whatever crazy thing, I'm talking about anybody that's a born-again Christian who's making videos about the rapture and the tribulation and all that, even if we don't agree with everything they say or not, you know, all these little doctrinal disputes, that we would pray that God would bless them with health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love. And if they have some doctrine that you think is wrong, then, you know, the humble thing to do is say, Lord, please correct me or them, whoever is wrong, you know. Lead us all into, you know, all truth and righteousness and wisdom by the Holy Spirit. You know, and that's one of the biggest things I run into on YouTube. I mention it regularly, you know, is people that got saved a month ago, and they're on there trying to correct me about all this doctrinal stuff, you know. And I always ask them, I always send them a private message, and I say, do you do the same thing to your doctor and lawyer, you know? And I mentioned in a video not long ago, I have an immediate family member, you know, from my, not my married family, but my family as I was growing up, who told me that they were smarter than, that all pastors were dumb. They never met a pastor that they weren't smarter than. Because I'd ask them, you know, this relative that went, got saved allegedly at like 12 years old, hasn't been to church really since they were 12 or 13 years old, something like that, backslider all their life, and they are always trying to tell me what the Bible says. And of course, they're always wrong because they never read the Bible. And then I ask them, you know, do you correct your doctor also? Because this person is a hypochondriac. You go to the doctor all the time. And they said, oh, no, I don't correct my doctor because he knows what he's talking about. But all pastors are dumb. I know more about the Bible than all pastors. Well, see, when someone says that, you know, There's lots of good proverbs to go along with that, to describe someone like that. But it's but basically, I would say that the Bible verse says God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. So that's what it is. You have to be humble, and we have to always be open to correction, and we always have to be, know that to respect people and honor people who are experts in different areas. And 90% of the people with them, they're like that. I mean, I don't demand that people would respect me as painting cars. I don't say, oh, people need to respect me and ask me questions, or I know everything about painting cars. I don't. If I had a car that needed painting, I'm sure there's somebody who watches me on YouTube who, I know there's a brother in Fort Worth. Now, I think he put, I'm sorry, this brother, I think he put sound systems in cars. He works at a place, and I think they do body work too. I can't remember, brother. I don't want to say your name. You said you want to be anonymous. But I know they put like sound systems in cars and all this kind of. I think they customize cars and pimp people's rides. I think that's what they do down in Dallas, Fort Worth. I think he lives in Fort Worth. Is one of the brothers I met down there in Dallas. And now, so if I wanted to pimp my ride, if I had a ride here in the States, because I don't have a ride, I would go down there and ask him to pimp it for me. I wouldn't tell him, oh, this is how you pimp it. Yeah, pimp your ride, because I don't know. See, so you have to know what areas that you are good at and what the Lord has called you to do, whether it be a ride pimper, or a mechanic, or a nurse, or a doctor, or whatever. And then let people be, go to people who are experts in the area you're trying to find out about. That's how it works, brothers and sisters. But for some reason, everybody thinks they're an expert on religion, especially people that just got saved. I don't know where they get this from. I don't know. But anyway, brothers and sisters, speaking of that, I need to make a slideshow and a report about the orphanages. But, we bought a van for orphanage number one and two because we have so many kids, and both of the orphanages are close together, so they share that van. But anyway, like an axle, I think I might have mentioned this in a video. Anyway, like one of the axles is bad on it, or the rear axle, or it's hard to get it translated. But anyway, we had to buy new tires, and then the new tire was worn out within 6 months, and it's too dangerous to drive. If we put a new tire on it, which costs like $100, it'll go bad within 6 months, and even then, could be sooner. And then whatever's wrong with it, something to do with the axle on the rear of it. If we don't get it fixed, I mean, it could break or whatever driving down the road. It's dangerous. It's unsafe to drive. So we need to get that fixed. And I don't know the total cost. I think I mentioned this in the video. I think it's like $500. And we got several projects. And I had one brother that has donated $500 toward all this. So thank the Lord for that brother in Minnesota. But also have we also have the orphanage number four. We have no transportation there. They've been using public transportation, but we're increasing the amount of orphans there. So what we're probably going to do is because it's a kind of a city area, so we don't need a van like in orphanage two and three, which is in a remote area, or one and two is in a remote area. So orphanage number four, we need to buy. We're going to buy a motorcycle with a sidecar. So a whole deal is like we could get a used one for about $600, but I want to make sure that we get a good one and it's conditioned. So I think that's like the minimum. They always give you the lowest price, but what you buy is broken one. I don't want to buy a broken one. So I think for, I guess, a brand new whole outfit, I don't know, say the motorcycle is about $1,200, and to make the sidecar and all this, it'd be like 2,000 for a whole brand new deal. But so I think for $1,000 or $1,200, we can get a good secondhand one. So that's what I asked you guys to pray. So let's just pray for the new stuff, and then we'll get whatever we got a budget to get. So that's $2,000, and already got 500. I think that'll probably, hopefully, I believe that will cover the axle problem, I hope, with the van. And then orphanage number three, brothers and sisters. Of course, I got to get new house parents, but of course, we don't have any transportation or anything there. So eventually, I will buy another. We need to get another motorcycle with a sidecar for orphanage number three, because it's in a city area. But that's in a bigger city, and you can't hardly drive one of those. So I probably need to get some kind of a small vehicle. And of course, that's going to be a bigger project. That's going to be at least like say $5,000 or something, 5 to 10,000. We paid $7,500 for the van. It was a good deal, but it had lots of. It's what they call a surplus vehicle. It's driven like 20 years in Korea. Then they sell, break them down, and sell the parts in the Philippines. And Filipinos, mechanics, and business people, They buy all these parts and put them together and make a brand new vehicle. Well, they make not a new vehicle. They make a vehicle out of all these parts. So, I mean, you can imagine, I guess I don't know how safe these are, because these are like that song by Johnny Cash, I got it one piece at a time, He worked at the song is an old country song, and Johnny Cash worked at a Ford factory, I think it was, and then, he worked there for like 40 years or whatever, and he stole a piece of a car every day at work, and then after 20 or 30 years, he put it all together, and he had a car that was, and they asked him what model it was, and he started counting off the years from a 55 through a 75, whatever it is. So, that's get all these parts and just throw it together. So that's a surplus van that we bought. Cars are expensive in the Philippines, more than they are in the States, because it's an island, and the government, of course, they have all these, unlike us, they don't have fair trade. They have all these tariffs if you try to import a car. The government makes a ton of money, so it's hard to get up. There's all these tariffs on new vehicles brought into the Philippines. So used cars there are expensive, way more. I could buy a car here for $2,000 or $3,000, and in the Philippines, the same car would be $7,000 or $8,000, or maybe $10,000. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been rambling on for a while. So I ask for you guys' prayer about all those things. I'm praying for all of you guys who asked me to pray for you, and I ask you to pray for let's just pray for all the watchmen. Minister Paul, I've been getting some messages from him. He's sending out through the Google Plus that he's doing all these things about the restoration of America and all this. And I think he's going to be at Fort Bragg or something coming up. I ask you to pray for that. God will give him success in trying to do some evangelism there and restoration of America and the Ten Commandments and all this. Brother Roy McFadden also is who's been playing Uncle Sam for years and years and years with the 4th of July up there in Oregon. He feels the Lord is leading him to go around. And he comments on my videos all the time. I ask him to comment on this video. We'll see if he watched it all the way to the end, because he'll hear this part. He watches my videos. And the Lord is leading him to go around and talk about the Ten Commandments and stuff and his Uncle Sam outfit. He does look like Uncle Sam. And so I would like to go there and see him doing that one of these days too, brothers and sisters. He's doing his Uncle Sam thing. I've seen the pictures of it on Facebook. So I ask you to join our Facebook group. I have lots of pictures of the orphanages and updates. And I post that all the time. And then I make the slideshows for YouTube. And I know lots of people watch me about the end times and all that kind of stuff and not about the orphanages. But James, the half-brother Jesus, said, we show our faith by our works, a result of our faith, the fruit of our relationship with the Lord is the things that we do, like orphanages, feeding programs, all these kind of things. Whatever it may be, as James also said, perfect religion is to keep yourself spotless from the world and to, help widows and orphans. It's also in James. And so, that's what the Lord has led us to do. The little child would lead them and try to win the Philippines to the Lord through the children. That's the ministry that the Lord gave us there with Joshua's ministry with the orphanages and all that, feeding programs. That we do. And I invite you to join. Below every video, I put a link to the Facebook group. If you're on a mobile device, if you go on YouTube, you can find me, Matthew Patrick Winfrey, and I think it's /5. I'm number 5 on there. And then I have a link to the group. It's Joshua's Ministry. I guess it's my name, isn't it? With a / Joshua's Ministry. I'm not sure. I have to look at the link. It's below the video. But if you Google it, you can find it. Anyway, God bless, brothers and sisters. God bless you all. And, I have lots of videos to make. I'll be back. And that video from the thing in Charlotte, I was supposed to have it maybe next week. I've been hearing great, feedback from the people there. They want to do more. And everyone said it was highly anointed. And it was a blessing. The Lord really gave me a strong message. And so I think you're really going to enjoy it whenever I get it. Like my preaching from the Philippines. It was all fired up. God bless.